Good morning, everybody. I can introduce myself now. My name is Peter van Asten. I'm a R&D manager of Fujifilm Manufacturing Europe. That's a site in the Netherlands. And basically, my responsibility is really about R&D in the area of life science. Fujifilm has the objective in the regenerative medicine area really to make it a reality. And that's quite a challenge. And in that sense, we think also that today's event is a very nice opportunity to present ourselves, because we are also very much open for collaborations in order to make it a reality. So I will zoom into the regenerative medicine activities of Fujifilm, but in particular focus on biomaterial which we have developed in Tilburg. And the biomaterial is based on a recombinant collagen-like molecule. And I will share a little bit more details on that, and especially focus on the microcarrier, which we think is an injectable microcarrier, as an introduction. Fujifilm Healthcare, how we come there, because I think we all know from the old days we had the photo film. That product has completely gone, and so let's say at that time the digital revolution started. We had to diversify our activities, and our strategy behind that is basically to use traditional Fujifilm core technologies for new products and new markets. And healthcare has become a very important pillar in that. If you look to the three pillars of healthcare, then we have the diagnostics here, the prevention and treatment. I start with diagnostics because they are the link with the traditional Fujifilm technology is most obvious, starting with X-ray. It used to be film, but later on it became digital systems. And another example is endoscope, because over there you need cameras and lenses. Prevention, also there is a link with photographic technology. For instance, if you have color paper, you don't want the colors to fade, so you need emulsification technology, UV agents, antioxidants as well. And also these products and technologies are important for skincare. And the newest pillar is basically treatment, where we focused on small molecular drugs. Basically, I'm referring to the acquisition of Toyama Chemical, a pharmaceutical company in Japan. We have our biopharmaceutical production site, our colleagues from Fujifilm Diosynth, and the last area is regenerative medicine. So regenerative medicine, basically this slide shows all the activities which we do in this area, starting with recombinant peptide. As an introduction again, there is a link with photographic history, because photographic products mainly consist of gelatin and collagen-like molecules. However, these are very susceptible to batch-to-batch variation. And photographic production processes are also very sensitive, so always we suffered from problems with regard to quality. Therefore, we thought, let's engineer a gelatin or collagen-like molecule, and then we get rid of this batch-to-batch variation. So that's how it started. So in the coming slides, I tell you a little bit more about that. And next to that, we have acquisition of JTEC. I think in 2014, we took a major stake in that company. And that company has two commercial therapies on the Japanese market. So it's autologous skin product and autologous cartilage product. Also, they do the development and manufacturing of that, as well as the sales all by themselves. And the most recent acquisition is in 2015. That's the acquisition of Cellular Dynamics. And their expertise is reprogramming of iPS cells, and also to supply differentiated cells, mainly in the area of drug discovery, but also cell therapy research. So we think that with this Fujifilm technology and the technologies of these two companies, that we have established quite a nice platform to, develop regenerative medicine business furthermore. Then going back to the recombinant peptide technology, it's a peptide which is produced from yeast, which are genetically modified and, in the fermentation process, and purified, and at the end lyophilized. The first product which we are have commercially available is based on human collagen type 1. Because of the way of producing, we have a very chemically defined product, but also the molecular weight distribution is very narrow, very small. Of course, you can. We all know the difference from natural occurring products like collagen and gelatin, which have much wider size distribution. Besides that, it's derived from human collagen type 1. We also enriched the structure with RGD sequences, amino acids which promote cell binding. So all kinds of cells feel very happy on it and grow very well on this material. It's completely non-animal, so also in the fermentation process for the yeast, there's no animal-derived materials added. So we can really say that this material is non-animal. It has a very consistent quality, and also from animal studies we already know it's fully biodegradable and biocompatible. At this moment we have it available, basically it's commercially available as a cell nest, the peptide which I just explained. With cell nest in this small pot, it's R&D quality, but we also produced it already under GMP at our colleagues in Billingham of Fujifilm Diosynth. Basically, this cell nest material is very versatile material. It is very easily dissolvable in water, and subsequently you can transform it to all kind of formulations. You can make it to dense microspheres, very porous microspheres, also sponge-like structures, anisotropic, isotropic sponges, or sheet, porous sheet-like structures. Finally, these materials have to be cross-linked in order to assure that when they come into contact with the aqueous solutions that they maintain their structure. And the degree of cross-linking also determines, also the degradation profile in vivo. Then I would like to show a little bit more data on the new injectable microcarrier. You can see a CT scan here. It's really a very porous carrier. The size is about 250 micron. That's in dry state. If you dissolve it, it swells a little bit. It goes to up to 380 micron. The surface is about a meter square per gram. And the pores are large enough that also cells can enter. So during cell culturing, the cells really enter into the sphere. So where do we think that this new microcarrier could add value? We think that's especially in the process of upscaling cell production. And besides that, also we could have value in to deliver as a cell delivery vehicle. We all know that 2D has its limitation, looking to the number of cells. So if you really need a lot of cells, then you have to upscale and you have to go to 3D. And with our microspheres and cell culturing, you can expand to the required cell number. Then at the end, when the cell therapy has to be injected in the human being, let's say with the current microcarriers, you always have to take the cells off the microcarrier. But in this case, that is no longer needed. Because the material which is made of the microcarrier is GMP grade, is fully biodegradable and biocompatible. So in that sense, there's no longer a need to get the cells off. And the size makes it injectable. So a few experiments to show you why we think that this is really adds value. First experiment is just a standard experiment to show cell proliferation. In this case we used MSCs. And you can see the culturing time up to 1 month. At a certain moment you can see that proliferation goes well, but at a certain moment you reach a plateau level, and that's because this surface is completely covered. You can also see with the electron microscopic pictures there the cells are on top of the surface of the microsphere. But the cross section shows also that cells are inside. And these are just live death staining, which can show that the cells still feel happy after 28 days, because it's all green and there's no red, so indeed the cells are still viable. About looking to cell production, it's of course important that you can really reach your target cell number, and as you already say, at a certain moment, if you start culturing, you can reach a plateau level because all the surface is completely covered. So what happens if you add more microcarriers? Then you can see that the cell number increases, and then that already indicates that bead-to-bead transfer occurs from cells. So they don't stick only to one particular bead, but they also jump or transfer to another bead. So by this way, it's possible to further increase your cell mass. Also, this experiment proves this in a little bit different way. You can here see the green and red labeled fibroblast, each separately on the microcarriers, but when you mix them, add new microcarriers, you can see that the microcarriers has both populations. So that indicates really that a cell jumps from one bead to another. So basically, we think that this proves that this microcarrier is really a good tool to upscale your cell production. Also, I mentioned in the beginning that we should be able to inject these microcarriers. Then, of course, it's important to know what happens in vivo. So what we did is just a subcutaneous injection of the beads under, in the red model. You can see here, after 1 week, that the microspheres are still there. And in a period of 4 to 6 weeks, they completely disappear. Also, histology shows more deeply that there's just normal foreign body reaction. And after 6 weeks, there are really no remainders or no scar tissue or whatsoever. So basically, the microcarrier degradation profile also eliminates the need to harvest the cells. So these are just a few experiments which I showed. There's more details you can find in the journal Tissue Engineering. It's nice that we made it to the front page, but there's an article in there in the September edition where you can read much more experiments related to these microcarriers. So I would like to summarize that our porous microcarriers are, as I said, composed of cell nest, which is a chemically defined biomaterial based on human collagen type 1. It's RGD enriched to enhance cell adhesion, and it's available in GMP quality. This makes, if you from this material make the carriers, we showed that we can enhance cell proliferation. It's injectable, looking to the size, and also the way that it degradates eliminates the need for cell harvesting. And furthermore, it's a biocompatible material and it's fully biodegradable. So we think this new injectable microcarrier is quite ideal for large-scale cell production and also in vivo cell delivery, so for cell therapy applications. So I would like to end with stating that we are very much open for collaboration with the outside world. As I said, we would like to make regenerative medicine to a reality. So that's quite a challenge. So in that sense, we would like to cooperate. So if you have more interest in what we have to offer, then I would like to invite you to visit us in booth 56. Thank you very much.